Xenia Manasseh.
Yes.
Welcome to Not 97.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. I'm feeling... I have a show later, so yeah. I'm thinking about that as well. But good is like the base.
Have you performed in New York before?
Yes, but not for myself.
Yeah.
So this is my first one ever.
Exciting.
It's so exciting.
Yeah. Have you spent much time here?
No, this also feels like my first time here for real, for real.
Yeah.
I've been here maybe 3 or 4 times, and that was all before 2018.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like I'm an adult now with like adult eyes, and I'm here.
Do you like New York?
I love it. I think I came at the right time, though.
Yeah.
The other times I came, it was super cold, and I'm not a fan of the cold.
Yeah, fair enough.
I'm a beach girl.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to like ask about kind of place, because you're from Nairobi. I know you went to college at Berklee in Boston. You've lived in Atlanta, lived in LA. How does like the place or like the space that you're in kind of influence your creative process and the music that you make?
I realized once I was old enough to be able to take myself on trips with no intention of creating music, and then getting there and music is just there ready for me. That was it for me. After the first trip, it was like, so now I must make sure that I go to as many places as possible, because it changes everything that I've written in different places. It is very reflective of my experiences there. I do think that where I am changes the kind of music that I'm making, and that's also the fun part, because it's like, what is it gonna be?
Yeah.
How does
Nairobi and Kenya kind of factor into being like that being your hometown, that being the foundation? Like, what is that? Like, how does that city kind of represent who you are as an artist?
It's like my core. It's like my foundation. I'm always, first of all, 254. Gotta shout out my country.
Yeah.
But I think everything about my upbringing there, the kind of culture that we have, all contributes to the kind of music that I make. I mean, some people would still call me an anomaly as far as the kind of music that people expect to come out of Kenya.
Yeah.
But I don't see myself that way, because this is all that we've listened to my whole life. We're like a hotbed for everything.
Yeah.
I know so many artists that come to Nairobi and they perform and they're like, this is the best show that I ever had, because you go and everybody knows the words to everything. So there's that. And then there's obviously my family. My whole family is musical, and I've listened to everything. And then you throw in Swahili.
Yeah.
And that's the part that I'm still exploring now in my music, trying to fuse that more and really, really find the sweet spot between my love for R&B and my love for Swahili.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you reject that at like early in your career?
I never rejected it, but I was, I don't want to use, scared is not the word that I'm thinking of either. I can't think of the word. But when I wrote my first songs, I avoided writing in Swahili just because I wanted to be grammatically correct.
Yeah.
Because my family is like, we are Swahili. There's like about 50 tribes in Kenya, but we are from the actual coastal region. And my mom will send me a text like, baby girl, that's not correct. So I avoided it for a bit. And then the first single that I actually put out that made me want to be an artist was the first song that I wrote in both Swahili and English. And I was like, oh, Okay. Yeah. So now I've been experimenting with it a lot. Last year I worked on this indie rock project of my own, but it's like indie rock alternative mixed with Swahili.
Yeah.
And cool. I feel like I've never heard anything like it before, so.
That's cool.
Yeah.
I think even just thinking about, you know, yourself as someone who speaks Swahili, but coming from Kenya, I can imagine for you over the last, you know, 5-10 years, the ceiling for artists coming from Africa has exploded. You know, from Ghana, Nigeria to like Tyler right now going crazy from South Africa. And I wonder what it's been like for you as an artist, like when you were younger, being like, there's very few artists that have hit a global stage, to now where it's like so much more, not necessarily common, but like welcomed and championed.
I feel like being where we are right now, well, it makes sense. But I also am grateful that there's no ceiling really anymore, because the possibilities are endless, and it can happen just like this, the change. I don't know. I think really the only view I have on it is gratitude, like grateful to be in the space that I'm in and grateful to have a community now that is just beyond East Africa. It's like all of us together. So I'm just like, I found my role and I'm just playing it until who knows what's going to happen.
Because I do think you are definitely part of that wave. And I wonder, like, from, do you feel that in a way, like, if you go back to Nairobi or the artists that you know in Nairobi, like, there's more, you know, they see the potential in themselves more because of what they've been able to see happen for you and a number of other artists.
Definitely. I just went on tour 2 months ago. 3 months ago, wow, it's June. 3 months ago with this guy that's in, I would say, the biggest boy band in Africa. And I met him when I was in high school in 2012. And they came to perform a show at my high school and I performed with them. And then 3 months ago, we are on tour together. And it's his first solo tour and it's also my first solo tour, you know. And when I went back home after Berklee, I remember having that reflection already, just knowing that everything that the people before me have done has like halved the time that it's going to take me to do the same things. And now I'm just like living through some of those experiences and like, I'll be like, I can't believe we're both here. Like, you know, and I also know that I've also halved the time for the next person after me.
Yeah.
So it's super cool. So it's like all you have to do is just keep doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I am curious about what your Berklee experience was like. I guess just like off the bat, your first experience at Berklee, like what was it like? Was there any sort of like culture shock when you like landed in Berklee?
I don't remember ever feeling like there was a culture shock. It was more the weather for me.
Mm.
I had never experienced cold like that in my life.
Yeah.
I got bronchitis my first semester. I was like, I've never even had this before. And I'm a vocal principal. Couldn't really do my exams the way that I was supposed to. But at the same time, there was also moving from a space where I'm around, I guess, normal people to just a space surrounded, to a space where I'm surrounded by people that live and breathe music. And it's just there every day, all the time.
Yeah.
And it kind of just feels like you're in a separate world, kind of. And then you finish and then you come back out to the world, like,
like people are normal.
Like, whoa, I'm hearing music and like stop sign in the traffic lights and cars passing by, and I'm like, does anybody else hear this? You know, so
you've never been that was your first experience in like a music school setting.
Yeah. I did music my whole life, but never really stayed at any schools that I took lessons at or anything like that. So it was like, whoa, wake up, go to the lobby. Somebody might be in there playing guitar. Somebody's like transcribing music and somebody's singing. And wow, I love this.
Yeah. I feel like some artists, there's like a love-hate relationship with like conservatory schools for artists, where some are like, this is the greatest thing ever, I feel like I'm a kid on a playground, and then others are like, I feel so stifled and like boxed in and I can't do what I like.
It exists for sure. I think the only thing with it, and at least I can admit it now, is the fun did get taken out of it because of homework.
Yeah,
it's like I need the homework to understand things more, but I'm like, right now I don't know if I can remember half the things that I learned, you know. So it is a mixed experience, but a great experience. Yeah.
Did you also studied music business and like management?
Did.
What? I guess like, honestly, that sounds like a really valuable
degree.
Skill and a valuable experience. And I wonder, like, looking back on that time and what you've now like experienced over the last couple of years of being your own artist, like, what are some of the things from school that like have stuck with you and that you've taken through your own career?
I honestly think it's still a bit hard to say, because the reason I did a music business management degree was because I tried to do production instead, couldn't do it. Tried to do songwriting as a major, and I took a class and I couldn't write a single song for the whole semester. So I was like, oh, okay.
Which is writer's block or what?
I think I wasn't ready to start telling stories yet. It just wasn't the right time yet. So I was like, okay, well, let's do something safe. And so I did a degree in music business, but then I left Berklee and then I became an artist and I started writing songs. So it kind of just like reversed in a way. And then once the music started picking up, then now it's like slowly started coming into place. Like, okay, what do I remember? What do I know? What's smart?
Yeah.
What's the best decision to make right now? Yeah. So.
Because I feel like with artists, I think an artist that manages themselves like can get messy. There's just a lot going on. But artists that do have experience or been like, yo, I manage myself for like the early part of my career or whatever, always at least have a better understanding of what goes into that, and a greater appreciation for the role of the manager or the role of like anybody that's on their team.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You can say that again. It's a lot. And it only increases.
Yeah.
And it's crazy. Like, sometimes I wake up, I'm like, whoa, if I didn't have the help that I had right now, I don't even know.
Yeah.
I don't even know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've heard you speak about Love, Hate Part One being kind of like, I guess, one of your most vulnerable projects to date, and like learning through that writing process how to kind of tap in with that, with like deeper feelings and be able to express them with through your music. And I wonder, kind of like looking back on that to kind of like where you are now, how do you feel like you've evolved as a songwriter?
I think I see the evolution through the writing.
Yeah.
It's always been vulnerable. I think that was the key to unlocking my writer's block, was that I had to talk about how I felt.
Yeah.
For real, though. So no matter what it is, That's where I confront myself the most, is when I'm writing, even if it's not a song. And confront sounds a bit aggressive, but that's where I face myself. Yeah. And I see that all I've noticed is that it's just become easier for me to communicate how I feel. It's so interesting. So I'm like, damn, these days I could write a song in like 20, 30 minutes. And then I read it after and I'm like, okay, well, we've got to deal with that. But also the clarity that I have. A friend messaged me the other day. I don't know, are you into like star signs or anything like that?
No, tangentially. I know what my sign is. I know a little bit about what the Libra world is about.
You're a Libra?
Yeah.
When's your birthday?
September 27th.
Oh my God, look at us.
Are you a Libra?
Yeah.
When's your birthday?
October 13th.
There you go.
Very cool. Okay.
We connected.
Exactly. So he messaged me and he just asked to get my like chart information so he could check. And he sent a message back just saying, everything here just makes sense. It makes sense. And it feels like you were literally born to help people figure out how to express how they feel about love.
Wow.
And I was like, wow.
Heavy.
Wow. But then the more I've sat with it, the more I'm like looking at my writing and I'm like, yeah, because it isn't just about me. It is about all of us as a community, and whatever role I can play in helping other people understand how to express how they feel, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. You recently dropped Phases, which, for lack of a better term, is the next phase of your career. But kind of what, I guess taking what you're saying about like, learning about love, teaching about love, and that being kind of like a guiding force and part of your music, what do you feel like the meaning of this like next moment is, or like the music that you're making now, like what are you hoping people take away from this new music?
I think the takeaway that I always want people to have, that I realized when I started, no, not when I started making music, because of making music, is that it's okay to feel.
Yeah.
And that's just something that I don't think we let ourselves do enough. Even now, I still feel like there's so much I'm still unlearning about. Like sometimes I'm like, why am I even thinking about this? Like, who told me that I couldn't feel this way about this? Or, you know, and the number one thing is that I know that people don't feel alone in their feelings when they see mine. Best part of putting out music as well is just hearing how other people relate to it, because it's never the same experience as yours. How do I feel like Phases signifies this new phase? It's interesting. Love Hate Part 1 is a collection of songs from 2019, 2020. Love Hate Part 2 has half of the songs on there also from that time.
Yeah.
But Phases is the song that I wrote the most recently. I wrote it in November last year and finished it in February. So it's actually a true representation of where I'm at right now. And I think that that's where my music is headed. That kind of communication and understanding. And I see a lot of compassion in that song and understanding of being a human being.
Yeah.
And I think that's what music is just allowing me to discover. So I expect to see a lot more of that.
We're ready. Is that the song that you want to perform?
Yes.
All right. So then I think that's a good segue then. And we can move the room around and get it ready for the performance. Do you want to give us the little radio intro of I'm Xenia, this is Phases on that 97?
Yes. Hi, my name is Xenia Manasseh, and you're about to hear Phases on Not 97.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yay. This is Xenia Manasseh, and you're listening to Phases on Not 97. Going in and out of phases. It's way too many changes. Time and again I wonder if you'll be honest. It's from being real, act like I don't notice, but I've noticed I can never keep your focus. And I know I'm not the problem, no, no, no. So I got a couple questions on my mind. Do you really stick around just cause of pride, or do you really think you couldn't love me right? Cause I won't mind if you don't lie, it's true. Hoping, baby, that you wanna fight. That's cause I don't wanna say goodbye. I don't wanna have to pay no mind to the thought of losing you. Hoping, baby, that you wanna try. And maybe all you need is time. I'm hoping we can make it right, so I'll it's not because of pride. See, if you put that shit aside, then maybe you could decide and see with crystal eyes. I'm the one you need. And I know it's scary, it also scares me, cause I know we don't want something temporary. You feel the way I feel that you do. Tell me the truth. Yeah, yeah. I won't mind if you don't lie, it's true. I'm hoping that you wanna fight, babe, cause I don't wanna say goodbye. Won't pay no mind. See, I don't wanna lose you, baby. I'm hoping that you wanna try, try for me. Maybe all you need is time, time, baby. I'll never have to lose. I'm hoping, baby, that you, cause I don't wanna say goodbye. Don't pay no mind the thought of losing you. So tell me that you wanna try. Maybe all you need is time. Oh, I'll never. I'm hoping that you, baby, I'm hoping that you want. So